Okay, it's fine.
I have a Yahoo here. Teresa sent it in. Thanks, Teresa.
My wife?
Don't. No. You've got this, Griffin. Don't.
It's asked by Yahoo Answers user Alexis, who asks, what happens if you don't do your summer work?
Oh.
I'm going into eighth grade, and it's already three-ish weeks until school, and I really don't want to do my summer work. And I don't think I can finish it before school anyway. So I just wanted to know what would happen if anyone else experienced this. It's a great question. And it's also a harrowing sort of look into the past of like what my life would have been like if I had internet access all the way up through primary education. Because this would have been me. I don't want to read the things they carried. What happens if I don't do that?
It is unfair, by the way. Here I am, Travis McElroy, full-grown adult, looking back on summer reading and thinking, that is mean. That is like if I had a day off of work and the boss is like, but also you have to work at home. Like, no, it's my day off. It's my summer. Don't make me do homework during summer.
So what happens if I don't, if I just say, yeah, fuck, no, no. I'm going to play Fortnite instead. That's my summer work, is grinding it out and getting some boxes with my buds.
If you do that, you just have to write a really, really cool report on Fortnite. And the teacher's like, listen, I know this wasn't the assignment, but you really blew me away with this Fortnite report you wrote that you titled Report Night. And I feel like you really poured your heart and soul into it, and you're getting an A+. And from now on, all day during class, you can play Fortnite.
You could also, and I've seen this, and it gets big hits on social, is you're like, go read Red Badge of Courage, write a report about it. You don't have to do that. And your report can just be one line on a piece of paper and say, I'm doing a protest against war in the book. So I'm protesting the war from this book. And awesome. you hand that in.
Also, I'll write your report for you for $10.
Travis will just fucking do it, man.
Yeah, I'll write it for you. I've read most books that eighth graders had to read.
Yeah.
Not lots of books, but I'm saying most eighth grade level books.
Travis, slice me off a piece of that Brave New World.
Well, they were at this old world, and it sucked. Okay. And then they were like, you know what? Let's go check out, I heard about a new world.
Stop. Is that really the opening fucking paragraph of your report, you dunce?
No, I'm going to start with kind of hypothesis. Okay, hello. My name is, fill in your name. I'm not going to write my own name.
That's very good.
And I would like to tell you today about a very important work that really, and I'm going to go on and on like that for a long time, and that's going to kill like two paragraphs about the impact it had on me.
Yeah.
Right, like it really made me think about life and how things could be different, but also the things that stay the same. A lot of that, that's going to kill a lot of it. And then I'm going to give you basically like a two paragraph synopsis that's based off of what I read on Wikipedia.
Sure.
And then I'm going to come back at you with another paragraph about like maybe things that, you know, it's made me see that I could do differently in my life.
Oh, that's
how
good.
How it strengthened my walk with Christ.
Give me that paragraph.
Reading Brave New World really made me think about how I could strengthen my walk with Christ.
Because of what in the book?
Because I want to be brave in this new world that we call the 21st century.
Anyway, here's a full page picture of Aldous Huxley. And the end.
There you go. That's basically it.
Bridge to Terabithia.
Okay. So there was this girl, right? And like I remember when I met some cool kids that made me think about fantasy worlds, a little thing called Fortnite. And Fortnite was like a bridge to a fantasy world for me, where I could be myself and scream obscenities at adults.
A living vacuum cleaner with a rifle for an ass.
really made me think a lot about, I don't know, I think she was sick in the book or something. But anyways.
She beefs it. Like, she definitely beefs it.
And she didn't come back, unlike my character in Fortnite.
She beefed it, not unlike the 99 competitors I had in that one very special game of Fortnite that I won this summer.
That finally made my older brother proud of me.
Ironically, one of them did fall off a big bridge. Take it to the bank.
George Orwell's Animal Farm has the courage to ask us, what if animals could play Fortnite? It's a metaphor, but nobody knows what for.
Hello, welcome to my book report for 1980 Fortnite.
God. Okay, well, we're done. This is a podcast. This is a podcast that you willingly listen to week in, week out.
Number the Stars by Lois Lowry. There's 36 of these dang things. That's what she found in her study of the stars called Number the Stars. For Griffin McElroy. I'm Griffin McElroy.
McElroy News.
The giver, more like the taker, of points from kills in Fortnite. Each word is on a different page that meets the minimum requirements. I will take my A.
Hey, Eric, can I talk to you in my office for a second? Yeah, Teach.
You may.
This is about how I wrote all my papers about Fortnite. I guess, hey, Eric, can you be honest with me? Have you ever played Fortnite? Yeah, I love Fortnite. I love, hey, Eric, it's just you and me here, buddy. You can be honest. I read the books.
Yeah, man. You collect all the diamonds, and you get to go into you turn into supersonic. I love books.
I love books so much.
I love books so much. I read ones I shouldn't even have read. I read Little Women twice.
This has been our podcast.